Good evening and welcome to the NFL Draft Edition of On the Sportslines. I'm Joel Mahan.
I'm Nisa Sorolnik.
I'm Jay Kaplan.
I'm Steve Ferguson.
The NFL Draft is 2 days away, but if you can't wait that long, pull up a chair. We'll tell you who's going where and when they'll go and why. As always, we're live tonight. We want to hear from you, so send us your emails at fanspeak@onthesportslines.com. You write them, and we'll read them on the show. The NFL draft begins Saturday afternoon, but the Miami Dolphins, holders of the number one pick in the draft, took some of the suspense out of things by signing Michigan offensive tackle Jake Long to a 5-year, $57.5 million contract. Nisa, is this the right pick for the Dolphins?
Oh, absolutely. This was definitely the best choice they could have made. Yeah. I mean, Long's an explosive blocker. He can steamroll defenders. And the Dolphins' offensive line has been horrific for way too many years. You know, and I, as you guys all know, I'm a Dolphin fan. The one thing that does get me, though, is the 1 year my team finally has the number one draft pick and there's no clear-cut quarterback to take.
Of course.
That kind of annoys me. But because I'm not still completely sold on John Beck as their quarterback of the future.
Well,
so
you know, apparently neither is Parcells. Mm-hmm. Because I'm hearing rumors that in the second round, they're either going to look to pick up a quarterback, Chad Henne.
Chad, yeah.
He's the name I'm being bandied about.
I would like Brian Brom.
Brian Brom, if he's still available, would be the guy. That's the guy
I
prefer.
That would be a great move for them.
Yeah,
it's interesting. But you know what? Either way, this is the right pick because whoever starts a quarterback is going to be a youngster, and you need somebody to protect the guys on the blind side. Long has the versatility of playing both sides.
Right.
You know, second offensive tackle taken first overall since Orlando Pace in 97. Pace went to 7 straight Pro Bowls.
If he turns out to be anything close to Orlando Pace, then that's going to be the steal for the Dolphins.
Yeah,
for years.
This is a guy who only allowed 2 sacks his entire senior year.
Amazing.
Well, it seems like all of you agree on the number one pick in the draft.
That's about all we agree on.
That's right. You're right about that.
That's interesting.
Of now, course. How do you see the rest of the 5 top picks?
Well, you know what? Me personally, I think Glenn Dorsey goes second to St. Louis. I think they need a run-stuffing tackle because their run defense was abysmal. I see Matt Ryan going to Atlanta at the 3 pick because Atlanta's quarterback situation was pathetic. They had Harrington and a very much used-up Byron Leftwich. They have got to take the only guy who's even close to being a franchise quarterback available. At 4, I see the Raiders taking Chris Long. Only because of the pedigree. I mean, he's Howie Long's kid. I don't think Al Davis can pass that up, though. I don't know. Something tells me Brian McFadden's nipping in his back here.
Darren McFadden.
Yeah. Again. And at Kansas City picking 5, I think they got to go with Golston because they need to take the best pass rusher available after losing Jared Allen to Minnesota.
You see, I have Chris Long, of course, going second. Now, he could wind up going 4th, as you said. I mean, Daddy was a Raider. Why not him? You know, that would make sense. Dorsey is such a good player that I can't see Atlanta passing this guy up because they need a player. Like, he's an impact player. They could get the quarterback in the next round. That could be Brian Brom. It could even be Flacco, who I hear is fantastic.
Yeah, he's rising up people's draft shards.
Very much.
People forget he was a quarterback at Pitt before he went to Delaware.
Well, that's right.
You know what, though? I think the Raiders might surprise everyone and take Darren McFadden, though.
Yeah,
I feel like, how do you turn down such an explosive player like that when you have the chance to take someone like that? Even though I know they've got, you know, a little bit of depth at running back, but
They do.
How do you pass that up if he's right there, you know?
I don't know.
Yeah,
it's
tempting. I mean, I have Cedric Ellis 4th because I think, speaking of players that are explosive who can have an impact, there's a guy who can really have it. Did you see the guy's combines? He was unbelievable.
Yeah, you know, honestly, I mean, I know we have 3 different picks for the Raiders, but you know, I honestly don't think, as pathetic as their team is, I don't think they can lose either way. McFadden, like you said, is a home run hitting back.
Absolutely.
Chris Long's a good pass rusher. Cedric Ellis is, you know, people are touting him as the next Warren Sapp, who just retired from the Raiders.
And you never even know, the Rams might even take McFadden. You never know
That's
what's going to happen in the crazy draft.
No, you
Anything
don't.
Is possible.
Yeah. Anything is possible. Though, you guys are interesting. You both picked Clady to go to Kansas City, and you know what?
They've got a glaring need there.
They
offensive tackle. They really do.
Considering the way that Larry Johnson got his butt kicked last year. I can't necessarily say you guys are wrong with that pick. It wouldn't surprise me. I mean, it is it's a deep draft at offensive tackle.
Absolutely.
So they expect, you know, at least 5 to go in the top 15 picks.
Yeah. Think of the Statue of Liberty play at Boise State, and that's part of the reason we
are.
Yeah, he's the lead blocker.
It's his claim to fame.
Yeah.
You know what? Ironically, you talk about, you know, Jake Long only gave up 2 sacks all year. Care to guess who got those 2 sacks?
Vernon Golston.
Very good, Steve.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
The question is, will Golston show up on every play?
We'll certainly find out, won't we? And now for another perspective, we welcome to the show Fox Sports football analyst Brian Baldinger. Brian, welcome to On the Sports Lines.
Hey, guys, how are you? Good weekend tonight.
Hey, Brian.
Hey, Brian.
Good to have you, Brian. Our panel has been breaking down the draft, and they have some questions for you.
Okay.
Hey, Brian, it's Jay Kaplan. How you doing?
Hey, Jack.
It's a two-part question. What effect do you think the Jared Allen trade will have not only on Kansas City's draft strategy, but how the rest of the first round plays out?
Well, I think it's going to have a great deal. First of all, Kansas City has a lot of ammunition right now. So they're in a position where they can trade up. They may be in a position where they may eventually have three number one picks. So teams may be trying to get to their spot for players. They have a lot of holes to fill. And I think that, right now that Kansas City, because they have so many picks and they have so many holes to fill, I think that they could be taking some of these elite players that we keep hearing about at all these positions, like a Derek Harvey at defensive end, like a, you know, like a Chris Williams at offensive tackle, real holes of position of need.
Absolutely.
Brian, it's Steve Ferguson. I have a question for you also. Do you believe Darren McFadden will be available when the Jets pick at 6? And if he is, would his character issues prevent you from drafting him?
I do believe he'll be available at 6 with the Jets. I don't think the Raiders will take him. I think they have a lot greater needs. I think they've got a pretty decent backfield. That's not their weakest position. Justin Fargus had a pretty good season last year behind a bad offensive line on a bad team. Lamont George is still there. Bush last year that they drafted from Louisville, who sat out last year. It's got a lot of talent. So I think the pass, I think it's there. I don't think the character issues are going to be the biggest deterrent to Darren McFadden. I think it'll be his talent and the way he plays the game, which will be his big deterrent.
Interesting.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Brian, yeah. Nisa Sorolnik here. With Mario Williams in 2006 and now Jake Long, do you see the signing of the number one overall pick prior to the draft becoming a trend?
Well, I think that they've tried to do that in past years. I mean, they wanted to get Jamarcus Russell signed prior. There have been a number of players, actually a surprising number of players, going back to Bruce Smith, who was signed actually 2 months and 8 days before the draft back in 1985, I think, five or four. So it had been done before, and most teams would like to do it. It happened with David Carr in 2002. Most teams would like to get their number one pick signed prior to the draft so they don't have a holdout like what happened to Jamarcus Russell a year ago.
Yeah, that's the worst thing. You never want that to happen.
Hey, Brian, it's Jay again. Listen, who's your sleeper pick in this draft? Who's your guy who's flying under everybody's radar that you think is going to make an impact?
Well, I don't know who's really under the radar right now. I mean, if you're looking at first rounders,
yeah.
I mean, a guy like Brandon Albert probably 3 weeks ago was maybe a late first round pick or maybe a second round pick. And now you may have to get to the top 10 in order to get Brandon Albert. I think a couple things have happened to him. One, I think people have done their homework on them.
Right.
These juniors, it takes a little while to really put together the information.
Right.
And then Howie Long, whose son played against him every day in practice, has gone to really bat for him and say, look, this guy's best football is all in front of him. He was a basketball player up until a couple of years ago. This guy has everything it takes to be a very good player. So I think the fact that Howie is trumpeting him has really opened up a lot of ears and eyes.
Interesting. How do you know? We have some varying ideas. How do you see the rest of the top five playing out? St. Louis, Atlanta, Oakland, and KC.
Well, I think it really depends on what happens to St. Louis. I mean, if St. Louis goes ahead and takes Chris Long, then I think it's a done deal that Glenn Dorsey will go to Atlanta if New Orleans doesn't trade up to try to get him. New Orleans would love to get Glenn Dorsey.
You hearing anything on that front? How credible is that rumor?
Oh, I think it's real strong. I mean, it just depends about the compensation.
Okay.
I mean, I think the Saints will make a play for Jeremy Shockey. That deal could get done. And I think they would love to have Dorsey. It just depends on what price it is.
Okay.
They've been looking for a defensive tackle now since Leroy Glover left.
Right, right.
He would fill a need. And then if Dorsey should go to either New Orleans or to Atlanta. Then Matt Ryan begins to drop, and a lot of teams would be wanting to get in position to get Matt Ryan.
Do you think if that happens? Do you think if that happens, does Ryan fall to Baltimore at 8?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if Kansas City, they've got a lot of first-round picks. There's no way they're in love with Brody Croyle.
True.
Yeah. no.
So there was a possibility there they could put a new face to the organization with Matt Ryan. But I don't believe he will fall past Baltimore, although Carolina will certainly be trying to get to number 7 if he's available there to jump in front of Baltimore to take him. So if Matt Ryan is in any kind of a fall, there'll be a lot of teams looking to trade up to get him.
Absolutely. Well, Brian, thank you very much for joining us. That's Brian Baldinger, Fox Sports Football Analyst. Brian, thanks for joining us.
All right, guys. Good to be with you. Thanks.
Take care.
Great. Thank you, Brian. Take care, Brian.
Okay. And time to turn our draft focus to the local teams. And for that, we'll go to our On the Sports Lines War Room and Peter Burke. Peter.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with our special guest GMs, Tiffany Beatrice and James Ferguson. Tiffany will step into Jerry Reese's shoes, while James will step into Mike Tannenbaum's as we go through the first 3 picks of the 2008 draft for the Giants and Jets. We'll start with the Jets. James, what positions do you think need to be filled first?
I think that the Jets need to tackle the defense at this point. There are concerns at quarterback and also at wide receiver after being left with no Justin McCarron's, but the defense ranked within the bottom part of the NFL last year certainly needs to step it up this year.
Okay, so you're really focusing on defense for the Jets at all costs.
I think
especially
with the number 6 pick,
right up top of the draft. Okay, very good. Now we're going to say that the Jets are on the clock, and that being the case, who are they taking with the 6th pick in the 2008 draft?
With the 6th pick in the NFL draft, I believe that the New York Jets are going to go after outside linebacker Vernon Golston from Ohio State, a perfect complement in the 3-4 system in order to try to help out David Harris, last year's second-round pick, as well as all of the new acquisitions, including Chris Jenkins and Calvin Pace.
Okay, so the focus is clearly defense, and you think Golston's the answer for the Jets if he falls to them at the 6th spot.
The only other guy that I would actually be considered at this point would be Jake Long. But in my mock draft, if you will, he won't be available at the 6.
Okay, and one other question is McFadden. Do you think that the Jets have, A, any interest, and B, does he fall to them at 6?
Interest, yes, absolutely. I think any team in the top 10 would be interested in a stud running back such as McFadden. But his off-the-field concerns are not something that the Jets would probably go after, because Tannenbaum and our coach, Mangini, tend to run a pretty tight ship.
And they have a refurbished offensive line, so maybe Thomas Jones ends up having a good solid season so the Jets can then focus on defense, which
That's
is
exactly
what, you spoke
what
about
we're
earlier.
Hoping for.
Great stuff, James. Super. Let's move on to the Super Bowl champions. Tiffany, what needs will the Giants be addressing through the draft this year?
Okay, the needs for the Giants first would be filling the safety position. After losing Jabril Wilson to the Raiders this past offseason, I think safety would be their main concern. Now, the Giants did sign Sammy Knight as a replacement, but if the Giants want to think long-term, they're better off going out getting someone younger who's going to be, you know, more of a benefit to the team and help them more. So safety would be my main goal for the Giants to get in the draft, so I'd stick to that and then go after maybe a linebacker and then maybe come the 3rd pick, go after a cornerback per se.
Okay, so your focus is on defense, similar
yes.
to when James had spoken about the Jets.
Yes, exactly.
And Sammy Knight, obviously, with some age, so maybe they can pick up youth.
I think they should go a little younger. I think it's going to impact them more for the future.
Great. Okay, Tiffany, the Giants are on the clock. Who are you taking with the 31st pick in the 2008 NFL Draft?
Well, my first pick was, of course, like I said, going with the safety. I think filling that glaring hole would be the perfect way for the Giants to go. I think they should go with Kenny Phillips out of Miami. And now Miami is known for producing some of the best safeties in the NFL. And now Kenny Phillips, he has competitive speed. He changes direction well. He times his jumps well. He's always there fighting for the ball. I think he's very vocal. He gets the teams in position very well. All around, he's a good leader on the field. So I think he'd be a great addition for the Giants. And not only can he step in at safety, but he can also fill in at corner if need be.
Right.
So I think he would be a good addition for the Giants. I would definitely take him first pick.
He's got great size, great athletic ability. And
exactly.
as you say, Miami's got a great pedigree of producing, you know, great defensive players overall. And a lot of their DBs typically show a lot of linebacker-type instincts, both in skill and size. So
yeah, he's only going to benefit the team. Definitely.
Good call. Interesting first round choices by our two GMs. Let's continue on to the second round and the picks that the Jets are up with the 36th in the 2008 draft. James, what do you think they're going to go with?
I think they go with a corner. I'm looking at Brandon Flowers from Virginia Tech. Certainly a good compliment to Darrell Revis, who was our number one pick last year, and we could absolutely use the help at this point. Our corners are certainly lacking. Our safeties are good with the re-signing of Kerry Rhodes for the next few years, but you definitely have to say to yourself that this would be a great pickup for the Jets.
And obviously with the hope that they had gotten Asante Samuel in offseason as a free agent who went to the Eagles, you're trying to bolster the defense by way of the draft, and I think that's a great call.
Exactly. You know, the only other thing that the Jets could possibly do is go with wide receiver here as well. But after the Justin McCarron's nightmare from a few years ago, who was a second-round pick, I just don't see the Jets going after a wide receiver this early.
Great. All right, Tiffany, the Giants are on the clock again. Who do they select with the 63rd pick in the 2008 NFL draft?
Okay, my second pick for the Giants would be linebacker position. I would definitely, you know, Tennessee's Jerod Mayo, he would be an excellent addition, especially if Michael Strahan retires. But my pick would be to go with Penn State's Dan Connor. I think he's got a lot of versatility at the linebacker position. He can contribute from day one. He's quick. You always find him in the middle of a play. He's always right there, ready for it to happen. He's got a great knack for the ball. I think he's got very good natural instincts. And he's physical, he's tough, he's aggressive, but he's also disciplined, which is something, you know, the Giants could definitely need. Someone that's tough out there, but also has discipline and knows his boundaries.
And Connor played successfully with Paul Posluszny for 3 years at Penn State, and so he's got some great reference there, and obviously exactly. Through a great program headed by Joe Paterno. Could
yes,
be a good
Penn
help State for the Giants.
Penn State's definitely great to come out of.
Very good. And now for the third round of our 2008 draft. Tiffany, who are the Giants selecting with the 95th pick in the 2008 NFL draft?
Third pick, I'd go with a cornerback. Terrell Thomas is definitely a good choice for them. He's 6 foot, 202 pounds. He's out of USC. Mm-hmm. He's a big guy. He's tall. He's well built. He's got that, you know, good top end speed. I think he's very physical. He's very aggressive. And not only his coaches, but his teammates agree and speak very highly of him that he has very good leadership skills and he's got a great work ethic. So I'd go with a cornerback for the third pick. But honestly, I think the Giants are in good shape. No matter what they do, I think they're in good shape. I'm not worried about anything that they
have a lot of young talent, so they'd just be adding to that.
Well, yeah, anything that they do will just be making them stronger. So anything they do is benefiting them. There's nothing that could possibly hurt them.
And always a great position to be in when you're picking last. It means you probably did well the season before,
yes.
And that's the Super Bowl champs.
Exactly.
Great job. Thanks yes. very much. James, the Jets don't have a third-round pick. They have two in the fourth round. How would you use those picks?
Well, I think at this point you still have to fill the remainder of the needs for the team. And that would definitely be a wide receiver as well as a quarterback. With the earlier pick in the draft, I would go wide receiver. I'm going out on a limb at this point by saying that I think that early Doucette from LSU will still be out there. If he is, he'd be a perfect complement for the rest of the offense. At the later pick during the round, again, a little bit of a limb, but it still might work, is Hawaii's Colt Brennan at quarterback. Mm. With certainly a power arm, which is the exact opposite of what we've seen out of Chad Pennington for many years, this could be a guy who could really help us in the future.
Yeah, I mean, there's some concerns with him being able to handle it and breaking down a little bit physically, but obviously he's got a fantastic arm. He's played in kind of a pro-style offense with June Jones out in Hawaii. So the Rainbow Warrior, maybe you're looking at him
right.
to come over here to New York.
You know, I think that we did the right thing when we sat Pennington for the first 4 years. I believe that having a guy like Colt Brennan learning from the books, from the sidelines for at least a year while Clemens and Pennington fight it out and duke it out will give him an opportunity to not only learn the NFL system, but to be able to flourish in it later on.
And certainly a guy that could drop to third or fourth round, you know, mid-level.
So absolutely. There's still a lot of question marks about him. Mm-hmm. I hope that the Jets end up figuring it out, though.
Good call. Thanks so much, Gene. Well, that concludes our War Room Draft. My thanks to our GMs, Tiffany Beatrice and James Ferguson. I'm Peter Burke, and let's send it back to the studio to see what you guys think.
Thanks, Peter. Interesting selections by James and Tiffany. And now let's see what our panel thinks. We're going to start it out with Steve Ferguson. Steve, what are your thoughts right now?
Well, they're going defensively, and I'm going the opposite way. I believe we need a linebacker. We need somebody with speed, and I'm thinking Xavier Adibi.
Mm.
Really good player out of Virginia Tech. And for the fourth round...
Who's your number one pick?
Oh, of course it's McFadden. Okay. We all know that. But... As for the fourth round, it is time for this team to get some fast wide receivers that are tall. Two guys come to mind to me. One is Marcus Henry, Kansas. 6'3", 207, possession receiver. Reminds me a little Keyshawn Johnson, a little more speed. The second guy could be either Lance Leggett. I know, Nisa, you'll like that out of Miami. Speed burner, 6'3", 190, runs his routes well, very well disciplined. If they have a third pick, you can go with a guy like DJ Hall also.
You know, it's interesting, Steve. I'm going to agree with you on McFadden. You know, he's a home run guy at running back.
If he's available.
I agree with Steve. I think he will fall. The Jets, the question for me with the Jets is, will they use him the right way to take the most advantage of his skills?
Good point.
Jay, what are your thoughts about the Giants' picks?
I agree with Tiffany's pick. I think safety is the way to go. If Kenny Phillips is there, he's the right guy. The U is known for producing solid safeties.
You can't go wrong with
that. No, the only thing I would be concerned about is the possibility that Washington at 21 may snap him up if that's the case. Terrell Johnson from Arkansas State, not as well known, but he's moving up people's draft boards. He would be my my second choice at safety for the number one pick.
I agree with Tiffany's second round pick for the Giants as well. Dan Connor, linebacker.
That
would be a perfect fit for the Giants.
And Jets?
The Jets, yeah, I actually like the Vernon Golston pick for the first round. I think that's a good move for them.
It's a question of whether or not he'll be there. So
that's, you know, very true.
Like they said, the great thing about Giants winning the Super Bowl is when you get to this point in the draft, once you get past their first pick, they really just have to draft for depth.
I think you're right.
So, I mean, as much as their defense got rated, not rated that much.
See, as for the Giants, though, I think a little differently from you guys, because I think they need to also look down the road at their wide receiver spot with Amani Toomer. I would go with a guy like Harry Douglas in Louisville. This guy's so consistent, catches the ball, he's ready for the NFL, he knows what he's doing. And if you have another pick at the third round, why not go with a tight end? Because you might lose Shockey. So let's get a guy like Fred Davis.
Thanks, guys. Well, our Tiffany Beatrice has been busy this week. After playing GM for the Giants, we sent her down to cover the draft. Let's see how her day went. Tiffany?
Thanks, Joel. I'm here at Radio City Music Hall, the site of the 2008 NFL Draft. Fans from everywhere make the trek out here once a year for a chance to be in the house where the commissioner makes their team's pick. We're going to talk to some fans, find out where they came from, why they made the trip, and who they think their team should draft. Okay, who do you think your team should draft and why?
I'm the sweet receiver from Texas.
Jason Campbell needs some targets. That's simple. You know, we're a great team. We just need one little piece to push over the hump. We'll think it's Super Bowl next year. What about you?
Super Bowl.
Super Bowl.
All right, good luck, guys. Thank you. Okay, what's your name? Where are you from?
I'm from Phoenix, Boston City, New Jersey.
Okay, big Eagles fan, right?
Yeah, real big.
Okay, who do you think your team should draft and why?
I'm a sweet. We need a good receiver. You know, Kevin Curtis, Richard Brown, they're good receivers, but I think Greg Lewis is going to be able to pick up the third
one. Okay, what's your name? Where are you from?
Chris Willis. I'm from Roseville, New Jersey.
Okay, being a Jet fan, how do you feel about the Jets acquiring Golston?
Well, I was kind of hoping for McFadden, but Golston is going to be an upgrade to our defense, to our defensive line, and, you know, we're going to miss Dwayne Robinson, but we got somebody else.
Now, do you think they should have maybe went after a quarterback, or do you think Chad Pennington will be the quarterback and be fine next year?
Actually, I think Kellen Clemens will be the quarterback.
All right, we'll see what happens. Thank you very much. Hi, what's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Kareem Simmons. I'm from the Bronx, New York.
Okay, being a big Giant fan, who do you think they should draft and why?
Well, I've heard this guy named Jordan Johnson, the safety. I've heard about him, and he makes some great plays and everything, so I'm hoping we'll pick him.
Okay, so you think safety is their main goal this draft?
Yeah, well, we need some of that safety as a backup plan, even though we did win the Super Bowl. But it's always good to have a little backup plan.
Okay, what's your name and where you from?
My name's Carson Lewis, Carson New York.
Big Jet fan?
Huge Jet fan.
Okay, now do you like the pick of Golston after losing McFadden in the fourth round?
Absolutely. I was thinking that Oakland was going to take McFadden, but great pickup. You know, he's a great DE. He should work well in the 3-4, so I think he'll work well in Kenny. So he's good done.
How do you think Chad Pennington is going to do next
year? You know, Chad's a great quarterback, but I think you're going to see a lot of Kellen Clemens in the middle of the season. So, I think Kellen Clemens is going to come in the middle of it.
So do you think they maybe should have went after a quarterback in there?
No, absolutely not. I don't think they're dire in that need for a quarterback. I think they need to fill up. They didn't really fill up the running back spot because we picked up Justin Chapman. We have Tony Richardson as a fullback. But I think for the 3-4 spot, for a defensive side, I think it's a good pick for Vernon Golston to come from Ohio State.
All right, I'm live at the ESPN Zone where the Giants just picked Kenny Phillips at the 31st pick. feet. Do you think that was a good position for them?
Yeah, I do. I think they fill a hole with it. You know, they're looking to add a little bit of time in their roster.
So you say safety was probably their main concern, right?
You can't go wrong with your safety out of new producers good safeties year after year, so why not?
Exactly. Thank you very much. All right, Dolphins fan, how do you feel about the Dolphins' first pick?
It's not the sexy pick, but it's what we need.
All right, anything else you think they need?
They need everything. They need one of each. Probably two of each.
Any specific player you like best?
I like Mario Manning, wide receiver.
All right. Let's see what they do. All right, thank you. Lots of fans, lots of different opinions. We'll see how it all pans out this fall. From Radio City Music Hall at the 2008 NFL Draft, for On the Sports Lines, I'm Tiffany Beecher.
Thanks, Tiffany. Great stuff. Now that music means it's time for the 3-minute warning. Nisa, why don't you start us off?
We all know what the most exciting times of the year are for sports fans. There's October with its baseball playoffs and college and pro football. Then there's January with its college bowl games and NFL playoffs. And of course, there's March Madness, which needs no explanation. But what gets overlooked sometimes is a different kind of excitement that comes with the onset of spring. Right about now, actually. The leaves are growing back, there's a palpable shift in energy, and March Madness has given way to April anticipation. There's the anticipation of the NFL Draft. Right now, teams are starting anew and rebuilding, and there's the hope that the future may be brighter if your team makes the right draft picks. There's the anticipation of the long, windy baseball season ahead. Right now, every team still has a decent chance to have a great season. There's the anticipation of the 2-month-long second season that is the NBA playoffs. Right now, more than half the teams in the league are still in the hunt for the championship, so you know there are plenty of fans out there feeling the excitement. It may not be as thrilling as the other times of the year, but there's definitely something special about the unbridled hope of April anticipation. Enjoy!
Baseball is a game filled with superstitions. Players and fans alike believe in the maxim, don't mess with a streak. They believe that engaging in a certain ritual will keep things going well, they'll keep doing it. If things are going badly, they will try just about anything to end what Dave Winfield used to refer to as a statistically unacceptable variation. You'd call it a slump. Boston Red Sox fans, more than any, know what this is like. For 86 years, they attributed every demoralizing failure to the curse of the Bambino. You would think after finally getting the monkey, or curse if you will, off their back by winning a pair of World Series this decade, Red Sox fans would relax a little with the superstition nonsense. Nope, not a chance. 2 weeks ago, a Red Sox rooting construction worker buried a David Ortiz jersey at the site of the new Yankee Stadium, hoping to curse the Bronx Bombers' new home. I don't know about the rest of Yankee Nation, but I just laughed when I read the article. I smiled when I read that Yankee president Randy Levine was having the jersey cleaned, put in a display case with a Yankee t-shirt, and sent to Boston to be auctioned to benefit a Red Sox charity. But the best part of the story is how this attempt to put a hex on a new house that Ruth built wound up backfiring. David Ortiz started the season in a 3-for-36 statistically unacceptable variation, including 1-for-17 against the Yankees.
James Dolan, where do I start? Yes, you doing your damnedest to rip this once proud franchise apart, doling out the incompetence, the indifference, the insanity, and unseemly millions spent. For this sideshow at the Garden, you should repent. During your horrific reign, you have been the king of pain, torturing us with clueless Thomas even through that sex scandal. Only you would let him remain. But suddenly, you've emerged from your drug-hazed stupor. Now we have hope for the Knicks' future. Bringing in Donnie Walsh, that's a good start. Now, step back, you've done your part. Stay out of the decision on the new coaching hire. Don't you dare raise our ire. It's time to trust the man who, unlike you, knows what he's doing. It's the beginning of winning and the end of losing. Regardless of whether it's Herb Williams, Mark Jackson, or Jeff Van Gundy, whoever to coach this team, we want happier days to remember instead of watching a franchise that evokes an anguished, shrieking scream.
We all know how self-centered athletes can sometimes be with their look at me attitudes. Few athletes exhibit this mentality more than Cincinnati Bengals Pro Bowl receiver Chad Johnson. Ocho Cinco is well known for his extravagant touchdown celebrations and attention-grabbing on-field antics. Apparently, he's been disgruntled since the better part of last season. He feels he's being blamed for the Bengals' disappointing 7-9 season. The criticism regarding his on-field antics, his sniping with quarterback Carson Palmer, and the release of receiver Chris Henry has him fed up to the point that he wants out of Cincinnati or he won't play. Now, despite a long-term contract with the Bengals that would pay him $3 million next season, he has demanded to be traded and has threatened to sit out the season if he's not. Bengals head coach Marvin Lewis was quite matter-of-fact when he said that he believed that Chad Johnson was a man of his word when he said he won't play. You know what? I applaud Marvin Lewis and his willingness to stand up to a player like Chad Johnson who doesn't want to honor his contract simply because he's unhappy. I agree with Coach Lewis wholeheartedly. Chad, you know what? If you don't want to play, don't play, but don't come crying to us when no one's looking for you anymore. Before we leave you tonight, all of us here at On the Sports Lines would like to thank Donnie Walsh for finally firing Isaiah Thomas as head coach of the Knicks. You know what? We just wish he had gone all the way and completely kicked him out of the organization. More on this on our next show. For Nisa Sarolnik, Jay Kaplan, and Steve Ferguson, I'm Joel Mahan saying thanks so much for spending part of your Thursday with us, and we'll see you in 2 weeks on Thursday, May 8th, for the NBA Playoffs edition of On the Sports Lines. Good night, everyone.
Night, everybody.
Good night, everyone. Bye.